better than that. I need better than that. Welcome to EA. Awesome. I can't tell you how excited I am to have you here with us at EARS, EA's Redwood Shore office. My name is Laura Teclemariam. I'm class of 04. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about building a multi-billion dollar franchise and the careers that do it. I'll go a little bit through the video game industry for those of you that may not be as familiar, and then hopefully we'll learn a lot more in terms of what EA does. So first thing, a little bit about me. My name again, Laura. One, I graduated from UC Irvine in engineering, electrical engineering, with a minor in computer science, and I'm also part of the family of supers. So thirdly, I started off in EA on our data platform team. I led our behavioral targeting, our in-game communication platform, and from there I went on to go on and manage the Star Wars franchise in product management. So, a little bit about me. Now let's talk about the video game industry for those of us that aren't as familiar. For those that are, well, this will be a little bit of a review. First things first, in terms of total consumer spend, so just looking at the impact of gaming in 2015 US base, we're looking at $23.5 billion. The Entertainment Society Association actually just released the numbers for 2016. It's $30 billion. So the number trajectory is going up in terms of consumer spend. As we look at demographics, our number one large demographic for age is that age of 18 to 35, about 29%. As we look at gender, which I like to look at, males still dominate, but that's okay. Women are on the rise with 41%. Yes, right. Who said that? Yes, woo, ow! Now, let's look at EA's landscape. So the first thing we should look at is our audience. About 10 years ago, it was about 200 million players. Fast forward to 5 years ago, it doubled, or went 7 times 7 to 1.5 billion. Today, it's 2.6 billion players. Had to double check. Now, let's put that in perspective. 2.6 billion, that's population of China, population of India, together. That makes up the gaming industry and ecosystem. What is EA doing to address that? We have more players that are now playing games more times. They're on more platforms, and they're across the globe, across many more geographies. So we have to extend more business models. Am I buying it in the store? Am I doing online subscription, and so forth? To do that, EA today has 8,400 people, employees. I'm one of those 8,400. We're in 31 locations, so things like DICE that are in Sweden all the way to here in the US. And we have a 4.6 non-GAAP revenue for net revenue. In terms of who we are, 300 million players registered. So again, let me put that in perspective for you. If you watch HBO, I'm an HBO fan. HBO has 134 million subscribers. That's half of the players we have registered, okay? So just to put things in perspective, my favorite show, Game of Thrones, they have at a peak, you know, on average, 7 million viewership. FIFA, 10 million. So just put it in terms of entertainment. We're number one console game publisher, Xbox, and in PlayStation, and we're also the number one most downloaded in terms of these verticals. And we're also number one free to play in Korea and in China. In terms of portfolio, we have a leading portfolio. We have live services in our games, which makes sure our games are up 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And we also have our own internal core engine that we're developing, things to help us with animation, physics within the animation. And lastly, we have a world-renowned technology platform to help us achieve goals that technology companies are fighting today. So let's talk a little bit about tech. Unfortunately, we're a publicly traded company, so I can't give you all our trade secrets, but if you come work for us, you will find them out. So from there, EA introduced recently this thing called the Player Network. And essentially, it's the concept that you saw that audience base grow. And with the growth of audience, we now have to connect more devices on more platforms. And our goal is to in order to improve the experience of our players across all of those devices. So you can only imagine the order of magnitude of data set that we see coming from different devices, different countries, and so forth. So our opportunity is large in terms of the technology we influence here at EA. We're able to look at a billion player network, engage with those players daily, weekly, monthly, yearly, and also look at the challenges of scaling across the globe. And so we face the same problems of data sets, security, platform-specific service that any other Google, Facebook company would face. Now, I'm gonna move us into art and science because you're gonna say, hey, Laura, wait a minute, gaming, that's not a tech company, it's a creative company, right? Well, we are a creative plus science company, and I'll talk a little bit about how that happens. So first thing, in Madden, for those of you who aren't familiar, we do array of types of art form. This one is called likeness capture. And what happens in Madden, each year we have several players that come into the game. And so what an art team comprised of producers, engineers, and art designers, they come together, they have like this big rig with like 12 cameras on it. And the cameras like generate different views of the players. And so as they're going through the various rendering and scanning in of photos, we're able to capture the likeness, the blinks, the eyes, even down to the emotions. And what happens is after many iterations, you start to see something like this, where it starts to unfold their true self. And it takes a lot of work from using technologies like Maya to using, you know, other types of engineering to hold data sets this large and files this large. And so eventually you get something that looks like this, a realistic player. And so people may ask, well, Laura, do the players really want to take that many photos? Come on, they're like millionaires walking around. Most players say, if you're going to make me look good in the game, I'll do it. So they're totally on board. Lastly, I want to talk a little bit about careers because I didn't have a whole lot of time to go into depth with my material. But careers in gaming, there's many careers. So just to name a few, first being product management. I'm a product manager. You get to manage portfolios, manage monetization strategies, manage business case studies around features, design. Why do we design games the way we do in a direction for a certain market, demographic, and platform? Those are the questions you're answering with your team. The marketeer, they're the person looking like, hey, did you know the APAC region in China is growing at this rate? We should go target Hong Kong. And then you have your data science and analyst. Okay, I have 4 petabytes of information that I need to be able to have an algorithm process through and weed out behavioral experiences so that we can make the game better. And then you have the core, your engineer and designer. They are the people that build the fundamentals of our game and make sure the game is up and running 24 hours, 7 days a week. Lastly, we just released a new game, and it's my favorite, so I want to leave you with this. Mass Effect Andromeda.
We dream of exploring the unknown, discovering what lies beyond.
The entire initiative is at risk. None of the Golden Worlds panned out. They're a bust. We need to find more resources, but that takes people, and we can't wake them up. Now more than ever, we need a Pathfinder.
Maybe I'm foolish, maybe I'm blind.
No way, this is home.
That's why I'm here, exploring the unknown.
Who are these guys?
Is it just like us?
Get on the shuttle now!
Nice work, kids.
He has access!
No more mercy.
After all, no blame on me.
Now you are part of the first wave of arms arriving in Andromeda, our new home for humanity.
Awesome. So again, EA, thanks you for being here. We're super excited. There's my gamer tag if you want to find me online. I will destroy your mission. But without further ado, I do want to welcome UCI here and also welcome the Dean of Engineering, Gregory Washington. I'm so glad to see you coming back, hopefully to EA. So thank you all again. Round of applause.
I feel like the new person or the new kid on the block. I just arrived at UCI maybe 2 months ago, and I moved from University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I moved my family right around Christmas, so we are still in the honeymoon period of walking outside in the middle of March and being like, what? We're not freezing? So I'm delighted to be here. I'm going to talk a little bit about games. My own background is that, you know, I cut my teeth studying cognition and learning around video games, commercial games, asking the basic question if kids are spending more time playing games than they are doing homework, what are they learning from it? And it turns out if you play games or you make games, how many of you make or play games? Or both? So yeah, about like 80% of you. That's not surprising news. But for everyone who does not play, which tends to be more toward policymakers, et cetera, that's hugely surprising news. So I did that kind of work. I then got pulled into the Obama administration. I was a White House senior policy analyst, where I advised the president on video games, back when we had a president who believed in technology and science. It turns out that he actually brought in someone who understood games, because the idea was that you could actually mobilize our country in ways that don't require big P policy moving down, that you could do it through behavioral economics, gamification, gameful kind of mechanics. Enough said about that. As surprising as it was, I mean, when they first, I was telling Laura this earlier, which by the way, thank you for having us. The last time I was on this stage, I was here as White House policy person, so I'm having a moment of deja vu of like, wow, I'm faculty again. So that was the kind of work that I did, and I just moved to UCI, and I want to tell you a little bit about why I moved to UCI and why you ought to be really excited about what we're doing across the board in STEM, because we are knocking it out of the park, but also specifically in terms of games, because that's my wheelhouse, and I get the stage for 10 more minutes. I'm between you and cocktails, so I'm going to make this short and pithy, I swear. All right. So for those of you who don't know, as Laura said before, we are in this amazing moment of games. The industry for games in the States and globally is huge. People like me and my generation, we grew up where we socialized around music and movies. Right now, kids socialize around games. That's the fact. Not only are games huge, but we are in a golden age of games. So for example, thanks to two big sort of market movers, there's more than two, but here's two I want you to know about. One was a shift to mobile gaming that maybe 4 or 5 years ago, a huge market shift happened where a ton of, well, because touch-based screens opened up, so gaming shifted platforms from thinking about it only on computers or only on consoles, but thinking about it in terms of mobile devices. I mean, all of us, I'm going to go ahead and say this. I will buy you a drink if you don't have a game on your phone or your tablet. I will just buy you a cocktail after this, all right? I mean, it's a free bar, so I can go ahead and make that offer. Right? Like how I do that? I will buy you that cocktail because all of us are playing games on these platforms. But with that transition in the market, something interesting happened. All of a sudden, this demographic that used to be considered sort of non-gamers and not serious or hardcore enough to be gamers suddenly became where all the money was at. So players that looked a lot like me, middle-aged women, right? My mother playing bridge with her girlfriends, right? Suddenly there were these markets that opened up that diversified who we thought about as the audience of who was playing. And as you know, once an audience diversifies, 1,000 flowers bloom. On top of that, you had this other thing that happened. So we have these amazing AAA companies. EA is the lead company, dare I say that? I can say that, right? Yeah. I'm going to say that now. EA is the lead AAA company out here, right? I mean, globally they are. But now we not only have lead AAA companies, we also have this huge thriving indie scene. Thanks to Steam, thanks to the reduction of cost and platforms to make games, now you have folks making games that are all over the map. So you have not only games that look like these, terrific titles, Madden, anyone else playing Madden? My 9-year-old trounces me on this game. All right, anyone working at EA, I want to meet the guy who does the stats for this. What's his name? I just read the article again today trying to figure out if I could get an intro. So the Madden series, or titles like Battlefield 1, these are huge titles with huge followings. Or games like Pokemon Go that took over our entire summer and annoyed everyone by the end of it, right? Not only do we have these kind of titles, but we also have like crazy weird titles. We have things like Minecraft, made by a guy who suddenly becomes a billionaire, not overnight, right? It's sort of like what Hemingway said about going broke. It's very gradual until all of a sudden. That's how it happened with Minecraft. But we have titles that look like Undertale. Anyone playing Undertale? This was quite the darling of the indie scene about last year. Games like This War of Mine. Imagine a war game where you're not just playing the first-person shooter where you're behind the gun shooting people, but you're playing a civilian having to navigate a war-torn country. It's totally depressing, by the way. And I can't stop playing it. I don't know what's addictive about this, but if someone can explain it to me, I'd like to understand as a social scientist. I'm playing a game that makes me feel woefully depressed and kind of inept. But sounds like all of my gameplay, so I don't know. Games like That Dragon Cancer, this is made by a couple putting out a game as an expression and a dealing with their child that has terminal cancer. And a game like Never Alone, this is this wonderful little game that became a darling on the review scene. And this was put out by Eline Media in collaboration with a tribal community of Alaskans that were concerned that their youth culture no longer were that invested or interested in their traditional story forms and aesthetics. So they partnered with a game company, they came out with Never Alone, and now not only are their youth interested in it, but actually like nationwide, this became a huge hit. So what I'm trying to point out is that we have this world in which the game scene really is in this global kind of thousand flowers blooming. It is a golden age of games. Now, you know, as we discussed earlier, Laura pointed this out, the numbers are huge, right? The market here is huge. This is still bigger than movies and music combined. If you look at where it's headed, the only curve that looks like this, the only same slope would be film, in terms of the market growth that we're experiencing in games. And you gotta remember, like, film is over 100 years old. Games are like maybe 40, 45 years old, depending on how you measure it. So we're a pretty young domain. One of my favorite stats, though, is this one. You know, every time I talk to policymakers and parents and generations that don't play, which oftentimes, if you look at sort of the deciders in companies and deciders in policy, it turns out many of them are from an older generation and they don't play games. And this is the stat I usually use to help them understand games, right? Maybe half of adults game, but 97% of kids game. And these teens, by the way, are now growing up. So what you're starting to see is this huge sea change where games are no longer seen as this sort of strange kind of, yeah, pastime, but waste of time. They're integrated in and they're considered a full art form. Dare I say it, games are an art form. And what's even cooler about games is that they are the place where science and art meet, which is what gets me really excited about them. So they're growing up, but they're not only growing up, they're going to college. So check this out. You know, 15 years ago when I was in cognitive science and I decided that, well, way back in time. So I was very interested in, in math and language, and I was interested in building sort of automated assessment tools that might diagnose whether or not like online chatter was, say, flaming out versus constructive, or, you know, sort of collaborative versus not collaborative. And I was working on those sorts of problems, and I got tired of building worlds in which we could run studies and get statistical significance on the things that we would build that would actually help help a group be better problem solvers together or more collaborative. But every time you look at the data, what you would see is that no one wanted to be there, right? So we could build places where kids would do stuff together and they would do it productively, but we had to bribe them to go. So I got frustrated enough to where I was like, you know what, I'm gonna study a space that's naturally occurring so I can actually see what humans can do cognitively when they work together online, because that was sort of my big nerdy fascination, right? So I started looking at games. I was not a gamer, I was a kill your television person, I'll admit it. So I tapped into my first game, et cetera. At that time, people told me that it was a career killer. I changed everything and went to doing a dissertation on games. And at the time, I was told, Constance, you had a great career, but now it's over. There's no place for an academic that studies games. So that was 2003, 2004, 2005. Well, now look, we now have 484 college programs in games. That's insane. That's less. That's what? A little over a decade, and we now have 484 programs in games at university campuses. This is a map that we just released a couple weeks ago on at a congressional caucus on the Hill. So this is a map that's actually showing you how many game companies are in each state and how many university programs are in different states. You know what's interesting about those stats? There's a 0.9 correlation between game studios and game programs. So the idea that like a university is here on a campus of a company that makes games, it's because we're a university that does games. And those two things are related. Academic degrees, well, most of them are undergraduate, right? Bachelor's only. A third of them are now bachelor's and graduate. We're growing our graduate program here, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But here's some of the stats I get really excited about, right? So now I'm in the mode of thinking about how many game programs there are, and what are game programs doing on campuses? Well, we did I'm president of an organization called the Higher Education Video Game Alliance. It is an organization that represents all of those programs across university campuses in the nation and also internationally. So we did our first survey trying to find out, well, what are these programs, and where do the alumni go, and what kind of jobs they get? Here's some of the stuff we just found out last year. You ready? So if you look at game design programs, we're actually doubling the number of women in STEM fields, in code-based fields, through games compared to any of our adjacencies. That's pretty exciting, because if you've paid attention to code-based jobs, degrees, et cetera, what you see is not only are women not engaging, but the number of women who are engaging in code-based fields is actually dropping, and it's been dropping for a while. So the fact that we're doubling it is huge. And it's actually no secret sauce. It's the fact that it's science and code mixed with art. That's why people talk about not just STEM fields for science, technology, engineering, mathematics, but also talk about STEAM, right? Adding the A into it. It turns out when you add creative arts to code, actually, when you add that, and second, when you add social purpose, you increase the number of women enrolled, you increase ethnic diversity, and you retain them better. So take a look at these stats. What you see is that we're getting double the number of women, but we're also retaining them at 88%. Now, I don't know what UCI stats are, but for most public institutions, 64% retention rate is normal. So 88% is off the hook. If you look at alumni of game programs, what you see is a 91.3 employment rate. That's 8% higher than the national average for college graduates. And alumni are actually going into more than just the games industry. So a little over half of game design and game studies alumni go into games industry, but the other half go into a ton of other fields: education, web design, network security, et cetera. And then, of course, jobs. Are they making money? Well, our graduates make 1.5 times the salary of the average college graduate. Although all of you are from domains that are STEM-based, right? Yeah, so that probably doesn't count. Probably they're in the same league with you, I would say, because I think that might be true of all STEM, though I don't know the stats on that. But here's one I love. If you ask alumni, are you happy at work? Would you do it differently? If you use Cantrell scales, which are what we use to measure things like well-being in the home or well-being in the workplace, what you see are these wonderful stats that show things like this. 83% thriving in the workplace. Thriving, you can't get any higher, which is to say that when you ask alumni who graduated from game programs that have only existed for maybe a decade, right? When you ask them, hey, did you get a job that you love? Are you happy in the workplace? We know that you're making money, but do you love it? Well, they look a lot like Laura, who are thriving in the workplace and actually love what they do, right? So these are all really great stats about higher ed and games sort of nationally, but why UCI? Well, having just moved to UCI, I don't know if I have like the worst explanation or the best explanation. I'm gonna go with the best since I'm from the outside, so I actually, things that maybe you don't realize are very obvious to me. So let's go with what I think are the obvious. So why be an anteater at this time in history? Well, you know, UCI is one of the top 10 public schools in the nation, period. It is among the top 10. On top of that, you have, for example, that it's called out for all of its innovation, like sustainable practices, right? And number one for serving low-income students. These are really important metrics for what kind of university I just moved to. And they're draw factors for people like me in terms of what it is I can do with my own career. 72% of undergraduates, why games? 72% of UCI undergrads identify as gamers, right? In here it was what, about, I think, probably around 70 or 80%? So not too different from this room itself. And of course, I'm sure you've heard, this last year we just launched the eSports program with a full arena. This is actually the first of its kind at a public research university. And there's a lot of national attention being drawn to our campus because of this program. So let's move on. In my department, I'm in informatics. And informatics has a really strong interdisciplinary sort of tone, and that's part of what draws me to this campus, is the fact that in the School of Computer Science and Information Studies, we have this really strong background in our department of social sciences, computer sciences, and not having to give up one for the other. So informatics is actually renowned for being incredibly good both at social sciences and study people, but also not denigrating or getting or losing expertise on inside computers and machines, which is actually quite vital. And in the game design program, what you see is that we now have 10 faculty. Magda, who else is here? Is anyone else besides us two? I think we're representing for the remainder of the 10. But we have 10 faculty. We have 250 undergraduates right now already in computer game sciences. But this year we had 900 applicants. So that rise of applicants that you're hearing about from our deans, it's actually reflected department by department. What we're seeing is this huge boon in the number of students who are applying. And as we do that, we're developing out our master's and PhD programming in core areas like game studies, games research, game design, of course, but also games for impact, which I'm going to circle around and say that's the kind of work that I do. And it turns out in the world of games for impact, there is now a decade of research. Remember that story I just told you about how, oh, you know, my career is going to be over because I want to study games and not fabricated places funded by DOD that no one wants to be in and I have to pay them to be there. It turns out that that was not a bad bet. A decade later, we have a bevy of research that actually shows all the positive cognitive and behavioral benefits of games, right? So in areas like visual acuity and attention, some of Bevelay's work showing that in fact, you can actually ameliorate problems with vision and with self-regulation of attention through action games. Thinking about historical understanding, literacy, fitness, et cetera. So games have now proliferated across domains with a decade of research behind them showing that in fact they have positive cognitive benefits. So let me say that again. Video games are good for you. Right, like you guys should be like, what? Video games are not good for you. I'm being transgressive and very naughty when I play my game. Well, you are, but it's also really, really good for you. Right? And by the way, in the federal position, we now have 233 program officers across 33 agencies and 4 White House offices who all fund games as an intervention on things like cancer treatments, scientific discovery, fitness, science, etc. It's a pretty exciting time to be in games. So this always surprises us, right? This long list that I just gave you. It surprises us, even when it shouldn't, because if we look at the basics of how people learn, how people mobilize, how people socialize, how people de-stress, how it is they use their bodies, it turns out that we as mammals play. More than just mammals play, this is part of what we do, not just as a species, but as creatures. So the fact that games are so kind of beneficial, we can all sit around going, whoa, this is very surprising to us. But in fact, it probably shouldn't be. If you think about what we do with the people that we love, when we have all that free time, we use it to play. And play actually has a fundamental role in learning. Dare I say, as someone who studies learning, that play is the protoform. It is the fundamental bedrock of learning. It's exploration in your space. It's figuring out what you and your, you know, cognitive apparatus can do in this world now. Games are just an architecture for it. So games are what happens when you take play and you structure it in certain ways. And that's what makes it so exciting, is that you can think about ways to not just entertain and delight, but you can also think about ways to structure play in ways that might increase civic engagement, that might actually reduce things like recidivism, that might increase things like empathy and awareness of other people, or self-regulation of emotion and attention. And that's just the kind of research we've been doing for the last 10 years, and I hope that's the kind of research we're going to be doing for the next couple decades at UCI. So I will end there, because I know I'm between you and cocktails, but thank you for coming tonight, and thank you for the great introductions.